the situation when I swear can be of joy, can be of surprise, can be of deepest regret or pain or anger. It seems to be the most expressive means to show your emotion.
This is CrowdScience from the BBC World Service. I'm Anand Jagatia, and this edition is all about the stuff you normally can't put on the radio. Bad language.
It will come out automatically without me even thinking about it, and I would feel better immediately.
I'm a nice person, I don't curse a lot.
CrowdScience is the show that runs off your curiosity. And it turns out that swearing is something a lot of you are interested in. A few weeks back, we mentioned that we were making a show all about swearing, and since then, our inbox has been flooded with your stories and quite a bit of profanity.
I used to play sports, and definitely I think a lot of swearing used to come out then. I wouldn't always swear at other players because you can, you know, get sent off for that, so.
I don't swear a lot. I think if you use it a lot, it kind of loses strength. You want to save it for when it's really useful.
Thanks to everyone who got in touch, we'll be hearing more from you throughout the show. But first, let's hear from the listener who started this all off with his question. Gadi Shalom from the UK.
I want to know why it feels so good to use bad language.
So Gadi, your question, can you sort of put that feeling into words?
Yeah, so it is rare, but in a stressful situation or when something happens that is unexpected, it seems to be like a reflex to swear, and it sort of feels good in a way. It's also the feeling after. So after you've stubbed your toe, for example, and you've used some bad language, it sort of diffuses the situation a little bit. But how and why? And that's what got me thinking.
Gadi says he doesn't swear very much himself. And of course there are people, maybe you're one of them, who never swear, even if you've been cut up in traffic, locked out of the house, or shut your fingers in the door. But many of us will relate to what Gadi is talking about, that sudden sense of release when uttering bad language, the feeling that certain words are charged with an extra layer of energy. So how and why do these words work? To help us figure it out, we turned to Dr. Emma Byrne, an expert on expletives who's written a whole book about them, called Swearing is Good for You. First things first, what actually is swearing?
Swearing is very, very tricky to pin down. We decide what swearing is by consensus, and a lot of that consensus is to do with what's taboo in that particular culture. Some places are very offended by parts of the body, some by animal names, some by illnesses, some by certain bodily functions and not others. So what I ended up landing on was that swearing is something that is by its nature taboo, and it's the kind of language that you would consider not using in certain circumstances, for example in a job interview or meeting your partner's parents for the first time. And it is the kind of language that we use either in shock, amazement, elation, to be funny, to be offensive. But as it's a cultural phenomenon, it is very, very hard to pin down an exact definition of what swearing might be.
Right, okay, so it's emotive, it's generally something taboo, and something which we've immediately run into, obviously, in this programme, is that it's quite tricky to talk about swearing without actually swearing. So we can just bleep them. If I say, that's now been bleeped, no one knows what that word was. Or maybe we can just say, like, the F word, which is an English swear word that lots of people will be familiar with. Or maybe we could agree on some substitutes, like flip and sugar.
Yeah, I mean, the problem with using completely arbitrary substitutes is that they don't have the emotive impact of a real swear word. So they're okay as sort of code to let people know what it is we're talking about. But it is very hard to know how to use swearing in broadcast, because you know it's going to have an emotional impact. You're just not entirely certain what that emotional impact will be, particularly on a service like the World Service, where you're speaking across so many cultures that the opportunity to give inadvertent offence is so great.
Maybe somebody who can help us navigate these tricky boundaries is our producer, Kathy. So you're on the call, Kathy. What are we allowed to say? What are we not allowed to say?
Yeah, I have got the BBC guidelines in front of me and they're very detailed. But they start off by saying that different words cause different degrees of offence in different communities as well as in different parts of the world. So like Emma said, we've got listeners in all parts of the world, so we don't want to alienate anyone. But saying that, judging by our inbox, the CrowdScience inbox, it's something a lot of our listeners want to know about and are very interested in. It's going to depend on the context each time. So just do your best to not offend anyone.
So we can talk about bad language, but we can't take the basically.
Watch it.
Anna.
Stop it.
Right, now we've got that out of our systems. I mean, there are clearly special social rules and BBC guidelines. But Emma, what happens in our own heads when we use them? I mean, do we process them differently in the brain?
Yeah, I mean, this is one of the most interesting things that I came across, particularly looking at people who've had something called a hemispherectomy, which is literally removing one hemisphere of the brain. If damage to a single hemisphere is so bad, so extensive, it's sometimes easier to just remove that entire hemisphere, and we can live with a single hemisphere of the brain. Speech tends to be very strongly lateralized to one side of the brain or the other. However, when you take somebody's left hemisphere, or somebody's left hemisphere is very badly damaged through stroke, and they lose the majority of their language, what you tend to find is that they will still be able to swear. It seems we lay down very strong emotional connections to certain types of language, and that is stored separately from the rest of our language. You can remove the entire of a left hemisphere and completely negate somebody's ability to use language in a way that is sort of deliberative and planned like I'm doing now, but they can still spontaneously swear. Swearing is so profoundly connected with emotions that the muscular movements required to utter swear words are stored in multiple places, so we have backups for when we need them.
Wow, okay. So I guess that speaks to kind of how deeply embedded swear words are in our brains. And what listener Gadi is really interested in is specifically about how swearing provides this almost magical physical effect, these words that can actually make you feel better when you're in pain, right, if you stub your toe. And so to that end, I've got a bucket of ice here, which Kathy asked me to procure. Foolishly, I perhaps thought this would be for something fun, like maybe champagne. But I think that was hopelessly optimistic. So I've got the ice in front of me here. What are we doing this, Emma?
So this is a reproduction of one of my favourite experiments, and in fact, the one that got me into the whole subject of swearing. So what we're going to do is see whether or not a swear word allows you to keep your hand in that ice cold water for longer than a neutral word. So we're going to contrast the word soft and the word sorry, Kathy, busy on the beep key there. Pop your hand in ice cold water and start the timer at the same time. And when you feel like you need a little help, you can use the word.
Okay, 1, 2, 3, go. Ooh, it's not warm.
No.
Yeah, I can. It is actually quite painful. There's not really much here that we're allowed to broadcast, so while I'm freezing my hand off in ice cold water, let's go to the person who came up with this experiment.
I am Dr. Richard Stevens. I'm a senior lecturer in psychology at Keele University, and I run the Swear Lab at the university.
The Swear Lab, that's quite cool. So, I mean, you're the perfect person to talk to. What made you interested in the impact of swearing?
This relates to just personal experience, doing DIY, having accidents, hitting myself with a hammer, swearing, thinking, why did I do that? And then when my daughter was born, there was a lot of swearing during the labour, and the medical staff said this is a completely normal part of giving birth. So that kind of brought the idea of swearing and pain together in my mind, and I thought, I wonder if there's any point to swearing when you're in pain. I wonder if it helps at all.
Before Richard carried out his studies, one theory doing the rounds was that swearing made pain worse. Bad language, the thinking went, was a form of catastrophizing. It puts you in a frame of mind where you imagine the worst possible outcome, like stubbing your toe and thinking you'd have to get your whole leg amputated. But catastrophizing would actually make things feel more painful, and that didn't chime with Richard's gut feeling about things. So he decided to investigate with the ice water test I just demonstrated with Emma, called the cold pressor test. Though initially, not on himself.
For the first few years, I'd never actually done the cold presser.
Classic experimental psychologist being mean to people, not doing the experiments on themselves.
I sort of thought I'd be quite good at it. I was terrible at it. I felt the pain really quickly. And what we found across all our studies, it's replicated really well. It's always worked. We always see an advantage, more time spent in the ice water for swearing versus a neutral word.
Now, before Richard explains why swearing might help people cope with pain, I want to bring in a couple of our listeners who've got some first-hand experience in this area. First up, Colin.
I don't usually swear, but a few years ago I had to be rescued from a mountain after an accident. I'd badly dislocated my shoulder and I had to be put on a sled to come down the mountain. Every single bump was agony and all I could do was mouth expletives all the way down the mountain. No other words seem to do.
Medics are probably used to their patients swearing at them, whether that's up a mountain or in a hospital. Like listener Rebecca, a radiographer and swearing enthusiast.
If somebody comes into my x-ray room and they are in a lot of pain, a lot of people will jump straight to swearing at me, which I encourage. Or if people seem to be feeling like it's impolite or it's rude, I will say, no, it's okay. Swear away. It helps with the pain. I read it in a magazine once. People seem to really go for it, and it's a bit of relief. It gives them a bit of a chuckle as well.
The pain-relieving power of swearing in full force there. But why exactly might it help Colin and his dislocated shoulder or Rebecca's x-ray patients? Another finding from Richard Stevens' research might give us a clue.
We usually see an increase in heart rate in the swearing condition as well compared with the neutral word. And that seems to indicate some kind of emotional response to the swearing. And we know that swearing is kind of emotional language. So our kind of working hypothesis has been that when people swear in pain, they're actually ramping up their stress levels and bringing into play a phenomenon called stress-induced analgesia, which is part of the wider fight-or-flight response.
It's a bit like soldiers on the battlefield who don't notice their injuries because they're so flooded with adrenaline. Maybe the emotion of swearing helps to get you pumped up into that state, and that reduces the pain. Well, further studies have suggested that it's more complicated than that.
We were interested, well, if swearing, you know, brings about this fight-or-flight response, it should make you stronger. So we ran a study where we looked at swearing, again the same thing, repeating a swear word compared with a neutral word. And we did show, as we predicted, that swearing makes you stronger. However, there was no sign of any of the fight or flight response. So we had the effect we predicted, but not by the mechanism we predicted.
Right.
So that tells us there's something else going on. And that's kind of where we are now, trying to pick up what that mechanism might be.
And that means I get to swear for science again.
Put your hands underneath each thigh.
Yep.
Push down, straighten up your arms so that you're lifting your feet off the floor and your behind off the seat.
Okay, so you're supporting all of your body weight on your hands on the chair.
Okay, so while you're doing this task, I would like you to repeat the word at normal speech volume and a steady pace once every 2 seconds. So when you're ready, go.
Okay. My arms are shaking quite a lot. You'll just have to imagine what popular English expletive I'm using. It features high up on the BBC's offensive word list. But it did seem to help. I could almost feel a little blip of release when I swore. People in the next room are really going to be wondering what kind of interview I'm doing. This went on for quite a long time.
Do you work out, Anand?
Okay, I'm going to stop. As well as swearing while weightlifting, Richard set me some other tasks involving blowing up virtual balloons. Because if it's not the fight or flight response that's making people stronger, he wants to know what else is at work.
I think it's entirely possible that there is more than one mechanism by which swearing can lead to effects. What we're sort of thinking is that maybe swearing just makes you kind of go for it a little bit more and become a little bit less inhibited. And there are some parallels with this. So, for example, people doing karate, when they kind of make a move, they make that sound, the kayap. Studies have compared the amount of strength people can produce with and without the sound, and they can produce more strength with the sound they were not able to say what the mechanism was, but again, they were talking about something like disinhibition, going for it.
Thanks to Dr. Richard Stevens. And if you want to help him and his team to test this new hypothesis, then if English is your first language, you can get involved and help CrowdScience to live up to its name. Go to swearlab.co.uk for more information on how to take part. So if swearing has this physical power to relieve pain and even make us stronger, the next question is, since they're just words, where do they draw this power from? Back to our trusted profanity pundit, Dr. Emma Byrne.
Yes, there were two contending theories as to why swearing is so satisfying. And there is the sound-based theory, which is that there's something about the particular letters and sounds, phonemes that we use in swearing that are very satisfying, the f and the sh. And then there is the taboo theory. And so when you have a look at swear words throughout history and throughout the world, it turns out that there isn't really any phonological, any sound-based pattern that we can discern. Certainly the two most commonly used swear words in the UK do have a f and a sh, but that hasn't always been the case. But when you look at taboos, there's definitely much more of a link with a society's taboos and the language that is used as swearing. I find it really interesting, for example, that in European French, a lot of the swear words are to do with bodily functions and bodily parts, whereas in Canadian French, they're still a lot more religious. They talk about tabernacle and the host, the communion host. And it's not that the words sound any different or that they're produced differently or they feel different in the mouth. It's just they don't have that emotional resonance. It's the same language, the same words, but they're swear words in one culture and not in another.
Okay, so I guess we can look at society, but also we can try and work out maybe experimentally what's going on and try and pick apart what's going on in the words. And I know that you were involved in an experiment with Richard Stevens, who we just heard from, where you tried to basically create new swear words from scratch and see if those words still had power. So can you tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, that was enormously fun. So I was involved in shortlisting from a whole range. I think we had hundreds of submissions from members of the public. And the two words that we decided that we'd like Richard to take back to the lab were fouch and twizzpipe. We decided on two because we had two different, essentially, hypotheses we wanted to test. One was it's words that are short, that start with a fricative, so that's a f sound, that allow you to expel some sort of feeling. So we thought that fouch was a nice portmanteau of something that sounds like a swear word and is also the ouch sound. There was also is it that swearing kind of makes us laugh and we want something that's a little bit irreverent? And so we played with the word twizzpipe quite a lot. You know, I kicked him right in the twizzpipe. Oh no, not the twizzpipe.
It is a good word. I think it's interesting because when you say those words, fouch does sound like it could be a rude word. So what did he find in the experiment? Did fouchery or twizzpipery actually have an effect on pain tolerance?
I'm afraid not, no. Because we don't have these taboos that are linked with those words, they just don't play right. That role. Yeah, I mean, if we went round banning our children from saying fouch or twizzpipe and told an entire generation that these were incredibly taboo words, there is a chance that they would grow up to be able to use those to have that effect, but only by making those words be taboo somehow.
You'd have to go to really great lengths. I mean, if we pretended that we had a culture in which ears were really taboo, then I could insult you. I could call you a massive earlobe.
Yes.
And that would be really offensive.
You oral canal, you.
Yeah, don't be such a cochlear. I wanted to delve a bit more into that idea of different taboos in different languages. Does swearing feel the same in different countries around the world? And so you, our wonderful foul-mouthed listeners, stepped up to help us again.
Spanish is a very creative language to swear in because when you hear somebody that's really extremely angry, you get full sentences with a subject and a verb and an object and full stories with their own narrative.
So in Maltese, I'd say like the most insulting thing that you could probably say to a person would translate in English to sperm, which is kind of strange because in English you would not call someone that without having strange looks.
The Russian is the best language to swear in. They are the most offensive of everything I know. And it's virtually impossible to imagine a Russian person who doesn't swear, so he or she must be a saint, I believe.
There is an interesting swear in Mandarin, Chinese mainly. It means doing something bad to your ancestors for 18 generations.
That's quite a specific number, and a lot, actually.
Yeah.
18 generations of ancestors.
I don't know, but like say, I'm going to do this to your mother, or I'm going to do this to your grandmother, or I'm going to do this to your ancestors up to 18 generations. I say that to my dad, like, where do I stand?
So although the content of swearing can be quite different across the world, from insulting 18 generations of someone's family to calling them a sperm, swearing does seem to be a universal part of human culture. And there are even reports of something like swearing in our primate cousins. Here's Dr. Emma Byrne again.
There are some amazing studies with chimpanzees that involve essentially fostering chimps, bringing them into an extended version of a family home. And the partners who did most of this work, Deborah and Roger Foots in the United States, they only spoke around these chimpanzees using sign language. And they taught these chimpanzees signs for all sorts of things. But the other thing they did, because chimpanzees tend to communicate in the wild by throwing their feces, is they potty trained these chimpanzees. They instilled a very strong fecal taboo. But once they'd done this, the chimpanzees started using the sign that they'd learned for everything that was to do with bowel movements, which is usually transliterated in the research as dirty, in the same way that we in British English use our own four-letter word for everything to do with bowel movements. They would use it to express their frustration. They would use it to remonstrate. They would call other chimpanzees dirty monk. And Roger and Deborah Foots write of walking through a lab and hearing these chimpanzees smacking the backs of their hands on the undersides of their chins. This is the sign for dirty, so hard that their teeth would be clacking together, and instead of flinging poop at each other, they were flinging this idea of poop at each other. And that to me was probably one of the most arresting parts of the research in the book, was that realization that as soon as you have a taboo and the means to express it, then something like swearing can emerge. To the point where these chimpanzees would actually make poop jokes as well. The height of their wit was about the level of, you know, when my three-year-old would sit at the table sort of singing bum or poo or wee. They shared the almost exact same sense of humour.
Okay, so potentially this goes back really far in our evolutionary past, which is, yeah, just fascinating.
Mm.
The other thing that we've heard from, you mentioned poop jokes between the chimps. We've also heard from listeners that swearing isn't just for insults or when you're in pain. It's often used humorously, and it's kind of quite bonding when you swear with somebody else. If we're thinking about why swearing feels good, that's also got to be part of the picture, right?
That's right. And there's some great research that looks at the way in which swearing helps build teams, and particularly how effective teams are when you have people who feel comfortable enough to participate in something that's sometimes called jocular abuse. And some of it seems to be to do with the fact that when you swear, you take a social risk. You're essentially saying, I trust that you trust me enough to know that what I'm saying is meant in a jocular way. I am essentially taking a risk with our relationship, not because I don't value it, but because I do, because I want to show you that I think we are this close.
The other thing is that in those contexts, it can also be quite funny and playful. And it's actually quite a rich part of language.
That's right, yeah. And I loved the comment from your Spanish listener who was talking about the fact that a sentence can just grow and grow with multiple parts of swearing. That idea of inventively using swearing to express all kinds of different things, even elation, like football fans on Twitter saying what a phenomenally excellent goal that was. That is not the word they use. But yeah, we use swear words to celebrate as well as to denigrate.
The fact that swearing is such a nuanced part of language, which can be used in so many contexts, means that learning to swear in a new language can actually be pretty difficult to get right. This got us thinking, what is it actually like to swear in a second or a third language? Does it still feel as good as swearing in your native tongue? We wanted to hear more of your experiences.
My name is Laís. I am originally from Brazil, but I've been living in Germany for the last 10 years. I've always been very careful with slang or with swear words in German or in other languages, because I always feel like it might sound very ridiculous if I use it somehow. It just won't feel natural for the person who's hearing it.
I'm Jane. I'm originally from the UK, but I've also lived 20 years in Malta, and I'm currently in Berlin, Germany, and I've been here for nearly 10 years. If I swear, especially like if it's sort of a reaction, then that will definitely be in English. But sometimes like it's fun to try out things in the other languages as well, just explore a bit the ranges of swearing that you can get away with in other languages as well.
My name is Jessel Hirani and I live in Conway in North Wales. I speak in Gujarati, that's my mother tongue. On a daily basis, I speak in English. I tend to swear in Gujarati because I live in a predominantly non-Asian area. I know that no one is going to understand what I'm saying.
My name is Jacqueline. My native languages are Mandarin and Cantonese. I've been going to Australia since 2018. And when I was in Australia, I worked in a shaving shed for quite a bit of time. And then the shearers, they really sweared a lot. And I asked them, I was like, yeah, can you really say anything without swearing? And they say, no. So I feel more comfortable swearing when I was among the shearers, but when I got out of there and then I met other people and they was like, oh, Jackie, that's really rude.
You can't say that.
Yeah, you can't
say
that.
You're not shearing sheep anymore.
yeah, exactly. That's what they say.
So there can be pitfalls to swearing in a non-native language, but it might also be quite fun to play around with. However, nothing quite compares to the giddy emotional power of swearing in your native tongue.
If you swear in your first language, or you hear swear words in your first language, you react physiologically, you start sweating, your heart beats faster.
This is Jean-Marc Duale, Professor of Applied Linguistics and Multilingualism at Birkbeck University of London. He's Belgian, but has discovered a lot about English swearing since moving to London over 20 years ago. And he researches the emotional impact of swearing in different languages.
If you hear similar words in a language you know, but not your first language, it doesn't have the same effect. These words seem detached, disembodied. That is a widely observed phenomenon in multilingualism studies. I think in the first language, the emotional connotations are richer, deeper. You remember a word and you remember how your mum reacted when you used that word. Whereas a foreign language swear word that you acquired in a classroom will never stir you in the way that your first language swear words stir you.
And as well as the fact that these words will feel different to you when you use them if they're not in your native language, there are also all kinds of unwritten social rules that go with swearing. So is it quite difficult to get these right if you're learning a new language?
Absolutely. When you grow up learning those rules, it's not too hard in the sense that you simply imitate what people around you are doing. However, if you're a foreign language learner, then your knowledge of these rules is incomplete. So it means that, like myself, it took me many years before I discovered what the C word actually meant. And I remember my colleague in the department, I asked him, I said, Malcolm, you know, what's the worst swear word in English? And he said, oh, that would be the C word.
Yeah.
And I said, I have no idea what that is. And said, oh, I couldn't possibly tell you because, you know, this is not a word that we utter, but I can spell it out. And then I said the word and he jumped up, astonished. And I thought, wow, so that's a pretty powerful word then. And he said, oh, yes, I strongly recommend you avoid it.
Wise words.
And just thinking back about the interview with Jacqueline on the Australians who were swearing so much, the sheep sharers. I mean, that is a typical example of specific norms within a small community that might differ completely from the norms outside that little community. So she quickly discovered that what was perfectly acceptable in one context was absolutely unacceptable in another one. And that's why swearing is so difficult, in fact.
Thanks, Jean-Marc Douala. And Emma, the takeaway from that, which might sound facetious, is that some people say swearing isn't big or clever, but actually it's quite sophisticated if you're learning a new language, especially.
It is. I mean, learning what kind of swearing is socially appropriate and being able to navigate different registers of language, understanding how people might feel. We devote so much brain space to it for a start. It's very, very important for the functioning of society.
I suppose one thing we haven't talked about much is the dark side of this, which is that, you know, obviously swearing can be incredibly inappropriate and vulgar and offensive, and it can hurt people.
It can. And quite often, if someone is trying to be hurtful, they might reach for swearing, but they're likely to go for things that are incredibly personal. It's not the words themselves that are necessarily offensive. It's what you think they're going to do to the person who hears them. And that idea of trying to limit people, negate them, something called othering them, say, you know, you're not like us, or to put someone down, to be hurtful. We don't need swear words to do that. And quite often we don't use swear words to do that.
So with the caveat aside that words do have power and they can offend and they can be used in really horrible ways, I suppose as long as you're not hurting somebody else, what I would take away from this episode is that swearing does feel good, and it's something that we maybe should cherish rather than writing it off, as we often do to children, perhaps mistakenly, as just these are words that you should never say.
Absolutely. I'd rather teach my kids to swear in frustration, elation, sympathy, joy, but not be mean, than the other way around. My daughter actually saying once, "Get me out of this high chair," is fine. But if I heard her call one of her friends something that wasn't a swear word but was designed to really hurt them, yeah, then we'd have words.
I think those would be good rules just for society at large. You know, you can swear, but don't be mean.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's a really great note to end on. Thank you so much for coming on the show, Emma. It's been flipping brilliant having you here.
Thank you. You're an absolutely fundamentally amazing chap to talk to.
And just like all the listeners you heard on this show, you too can get in touch with us if you have a question. Here's our very polite listener, Gadi, with details of how to do that as he ends the show.
That's all for this episode of Crowd Science from the BBC World Service. Today's question was from me, Gadi, in the UK. I hope you weren't offended. If you have any science questions for the team, please send an email to crowdscience@bbc.co.uk. Thanks for listening. Bye.